we have an artifact that lives in our house, and maybe you have one too, although probably not many of you anymore. It's called a VCR. We've had this VCR for a long time. It won't die. It refuses to die, and several years ago, when my kids were little, we came across somebody who had dumped their stash of Disney movies at the Goodwill, and they were all for the VCR, and we thought, we have one of those. Nobody else does, so they all dumped them at the Goodwill, but we acquired a huge Disney collection that probably nobody else can play, but we still have. And so this led to several months of watching over and over Mary Poppins. My kids loved Mary Poppins, and it was actually a movie that I could stand to see. Oh, maybe not over and over and over and over, but several times I could stand to see it. It's a lovely movie. And because my mom is a teacher, she had insisted that I also read the books and not just see the movie. And she got my daughter the book as well, because that would be heresy for someone to see the movie and not read the book when they exist. So we read the books as well. And I forgot just how bizarre the stories of Mary Poppins are, especially in the books. She is this magical nanny that comes into a house, and in the movie, it's condensed a little bit, but it's the same in the books. She comes into a house and she does magical things. They think that they're gonna get this nanny. The father thinks they want someone who is going to do this and going to do that. He has a very precise idea of what a British nanny should be. Very strict, very, you know, making the kids toe the line. And then in comes Mary Poppins, and she literally blows right past him and up the stairs to her room before he knows what's happened. He's hired a nanny, Mary Poppins. And so she's in the house, and it's not long before they figure out that she is not a regular nanny. She's magic. They do all kinds of things that normal nannies wouldn't do. They go and look at a chalk drawing in the park, but before they know it, they've jumped into the chalk drawing, and they're on an outing, and they're riding horses through the countryside, except the horses aren't attached to a carousel, and everything's cartoon, and there's penguins, and it's magic. And that's what she's come to the house to do. She comes there and she introduces them to the magic, and in the book, she even takes them up into the sky, and they get to give the moon a hug and talk to the moon and talk to the stars and ask the moon and the stars questions about life. Very bizarre, like I said, but great, really wonderful. But in the movie, something weird happens. After she's shown them all these magical things, all these wonderful things, she's the best nanny ever, she leaves. And it even still seems like a happy ending. You would think that the happy ending would be that she stayed forever, and one of the kids, the little boy, looks up at her at one point and says, "You aren't ever going to leave us, are you?" And she says, "I'll leave when the wind changes." And you know at the end of the movie that the wind has changed, because you see the family that are going off to do an outing, and you know that the family is finally enjoying each other again, and the dad who works at a bank and doesn't pay attention to the children much, he's leading the procession outside to go fly a kite. And you see Mary Poppins' face, and she's sad, but she knows her work there is done. And so she can leave without a backward glance, and the implication is that she's on to another family that needs her services. She can leave because she's done what she came to do. In our gospel story today, I think the point is that Jesus leaves. I think it's the point for Mary Poppins too. If you get down to it, the point is that they do what they come to do, and then they leave. In the gospel story, Jesus has come to this town, and he's been preaching in the synagogue, and he goes across the street to his friend Peter's house, and Peter's mother-in-law is sick with a fever, and so he takes her by the hand and heals her instantly, and she gets up and begins to serve them, begins to wait on them. And the word there, if you thought she fixed dinner, the word there is what's used for a pastor. So maybe she presided at communion that day. We don't know. But she got up and began to serve them. And once people heard about this, the whole village came, and they gathered in front of the door. Mark, in the Gospel of Mark, likes to exaggerate a lot, so maybe it wasn't quite the whole village. in this little tiny door, but there were a lot of people gathered around because they heard that somebody got healed, and they wanted that. And so can you imagine, you heard somebody was healed instantly of a fever. And a fever was serious business then. And so you take your mother and your brother and your friends and that person on your block who's had that thing for forever, you bring them there because there's somebody who's a healer. And it says, and he healed, and he cast out demons, and he did all these things. And eventually, it sounds like he did get a little bit of sleep. And then very early that morning, he goes out to a high mountain to pray. He goes out to that mountain, and he prays. But then the disciples, they start looking for him, because everybody in the village wants him to come back. They are looking for him. They want more of that healing. There's more people who haven't been healed yet. And what Jesus does, because Jesus is a caring kind of guy, he doesn't even mention them at all. He doesn't even mention all those people that are still left in the village, still to be healed. He just says, let's go on. Why does he do this? Jesus is a terrible pastor. Any one of us would get fired for that. All these people, they're waiting to see you and you just leave and go on to the next town? Why does he do that? He leaves all these people, they're waiting for him. They see everyone is searching for you. Everyone wants a piece of you. The word means crave. Everybody was craving to look for Jesus and find him. And yet, he doesn't even talk about those people that are left. He just says, let's go on to the next town. I didn't get this at all until I thought about Mary Poppins. If you know what your mission is, if you know what you've come to do, it's very easy to know when you're done and to go on to the next thing that God has for you to do. Mary Poppins' mission, if you want to call it that, was to go into a family and was to teach them about the magic that's in everyday life and to teach them to enjoy each other and to teach them to play and to show them what's right outside their door and that they can do that together. And when her work was done, she could have stayed, but she knew that it was done. And so she left. She went on to the next family without even a backward glance. Jesus knew what his mission was too. He says it right in the Gospel of Mark. He doesn't say, my mission is to come and heal everyone everywhere, because that'd be impossible. His message was to preach the gospel. That was it. He says, that's what I came out to do, was to preach the gospel, and to preach the gospel of God's grace, that when we repent and turn back to God, God is standing right there waiting for us. That's what Jesus came out to do. So he came into this first village, and he healed, and he taught, and he preached the gospel. And I bet that when he was ready to leave, when he was on that mountain, the whole village, all they could talk about was Jesus. All they could talk about was God and the healing that God had brought when God was among them in their midst. And so he knew they had heard their message, and his work there was done. And so he could go on to the next village without even a backward glance, because that's what he came to do. When you know what your mission is, you won't be distracted by people saying, everyone needs you. Everyone needs a piece of you. People need you here and people need you there. If you know what your mission is, you know when it's time to go on to the next town and leave it all behind, whatever that might mean. If you know as an individual what your mission is, it's easier to move on and go on to other things when you need to, rather than be pulled by all of those many needs that might not have anything to do with what we're all called to do, which is preach the gospel, which is share it, which I know you do more than I can because you go so many places. You can preach it everywhere you are. You can show people who you are. Just by being you and just by showing them love and concern. That's what our call is. And when we know what our mission is, we can tune out all those other things that pull on us. 33 years ago, somebody looked in the phone book to find Holy Trinity Lutheran Church, and they found an address, And they went to that address. It was by the Big Chicken. But there was no church there. And so then they went somewhere else, but there was no church there. And then they went here, and there was no church here, because they were worshiping in a school in Kincaid Elementary, Holy Trinity was. Only 33 years ago, this church made the decision that if they moved from all the way by the Big Chicken, which now seems like a million miles away, to here, they could reach more people with the gospel. If they picked up and moved, can you imagine this sanctuary not being here and worshiping in a school? They made that sacrifice, they made that commitment because they knew that it was time to move on. They knew that it was time to leave the old behind and move on because more people could hear the gospel. More people could hear this message of God's grace for this broken world if they had the courage to move on. And so that's what they did, and I've been hearing stories this weekend about what that was like, and I heard of someone who had a funeral in the school because that was where church was, because that's where the people were. What courage that must have taken. I've heard of baptisms in all the places, but that's what it took, the courage for them to step out in faith and say, our mission is to reach as many people as possible with the message of God's grace. And so when it's time for us to move on, we moved on to this place. Because it's about our mission. It's not necessarily about this building. It's not necessarily about where we are. It's about that call from Jesus. And like Mary Poppins, and like Jesus, when we know what we're called to do, when we know where we are and who we are, we can move on when we need to move on until this amazing future that God has prepared for us. Jesus didn't go by himself. Did you notice that? He said, let's go. And the disciples followed him. And when we follow him, we find that it's on the journey that we're healed. Amen.